At the 1996 AES convention in Copenhagen, the formerly CBS Research Lab introduced Direct Stream Digital, DSD for short, as an archive format that offered compact files while it contains sufficient information for conversion to sample rates as high as 352.8 kHz, unheard of in 1996. From there it went on to SACD and now to DSD downloads. Record company CBS was bought by Sony in 1987, and the CBS Research Lab might have been renamed by then, but somehow anyone on the show knew it were the same people that for instance made the famous CBS test disc. Their idea was elegantly simple, just store the output of the Deltasigma modulator that is used in the analog to digital converter. Okay, let's explain that first by explaining what a delta modulator does. It simply compares two voltages in time, and when the second voltage is higher than the first, it outputs a 1, and when it's lower, it outputs a 0. Delta is used in math to indicate a difference, hence the name delta modulator. To increase the resolution, the output of the delta modulator is also sent to a 1-bit DAC and added to the input signal of the delta modulator to reduce errors. For those that find this a bit cryptic, compare it to cycling. When you had your first try to ride a bike, you made very coarse steering movements, making you go all over the place. Over time you learn to control this better by monitoring the result of each steering action and making corrections that are monitored and corrected again. A delta sigma modulator does about the same. The alternative is the multi-level converter, where the input voltage is compared to 16 reference voltages. The problem is that getting the smallest reference voltage precise enough was and still is rather difficult under other than laboratory conditions. And even then. The Deltasigma converter was far easier to get precise results from, and it was then a matter of digital processing to convert a 1-bit output to 16 and later 24-bit files. This principle is commonly used in audio. The people at Sony must have thought it to be a good idea just to skip the conversion of the 1-bit signal coming from the A to D converter and just register this signal for archiving. You do need a higher sampling rate, standard was the 64 times 44.1 kHz, but then you would equal a PCM quality of 352.8 kHz at 24 bits, while the file is slightly smaller than a 192 kHz 16-bit signal. This would have been great, especially for digitizing analog masters, for the anti-aliasing filters needed for digitizing would have little negative effects in the audible spectrum. Furthermore, it is ideal for archiving since it can easily be converted to 44.1 or any multiple thereof. But many analog to digital converters today use a scheme that is in between 1-bit and full multi-bit. For instance, a 5-bit converter, after which the signal is converted to the required 1, 16 or 24-bit system. So chances are the DAC output has to be converted anyway, whether you use PCM or DSD. By the way, DSD theoretically is also a form of PCM, but when I say PCM in this video, I mean multi-bit PCM, while I will use DSD for the 1-bit system. When the CD was becoming of age, Sony and Philips were faced with a serious problem. The enormous license fee they received every year was about to halt, since after 25 years the patent would expire. Oh, for those that blame MQA for trying to burden the music industry by patent money, you have paid patent rights over every CD player and CD album for 25 years, and rightly so. Only one in so many formats succeed, and they have lost big money on failed systems like digital compact cassette and mini disc. But I digress. They needed a new music format to keep the license fees coming in, and while we're at it, correct some errors the CD and the DVD had, commercially that is. For it should have the best copy protection in the world. And it did. I don't think that copy protection is cracked even to this day. There are workarounds, and since Sony and Philips lost interest in SACD, there might be more workarounds coming to market. As a carrier, it got the Blu-ray disc format that would have had more than sufficient storage space for albums in the 384 kHz sampling, but using a proprietary format like DSD was yet another layer of protection against copycats. No one then could play DSD streams, and all SACD players as part of the licensing had the digital output blocked when DSD was played. By the way, the recent attempt to fill Blu-ray discs with 24-bit 96 or 192 kHz audio and issue them using the Blu-ray audio moniker is a bit odd since the quality, at least theoretical, is lower than SACD, while the price is often higher than the downloads from sites like HiResAudio.com and HD Tracks. Back to DSD. How can a 1-bit system produce proper audio? Every bit offers 6 dB dynamic range, and thus DSD has only 6 dB dynamic range. But DSD 64, that is DSD at 64 times the sampling frequency of CD, has a 64-fold resolution in time. Using noise shaping, a dynamic range equal to about 20-bit PCM is achieved, while mid-range time smearing is low due to the high sample rate. The only disadvantage is that there will be a lot of noise above 20 kHz. It is always the question whether an amplifier has to work hard to get the 50 kHz noise signal out, while the tweeters might run hot producing tones that will only scare the rats out of your house, if any of those conditions are applicable at your place. Normally the noise will cause little concern. Switching to DSD as a copy protection might have been a smart move, and I'm only guessing they use DSD for this reason. In the studio, DSD was very difficult to do post-production on. With PCM, each sample clearly says what part of the output voltage it represents. Not so with DSD, for each sample only indicates if that sample was higher in level than the previous sample. An audio workstation was designed to temporarily convert content just before and just after a cut to PCM, make the cut and transfer it back to DSD, all in the background. But rather soon, editing station manufacturers came with DXD as a solution. The entire DSD file was converted to PCM at 352.8 kHz and 24-bit depth. DXD stands for Digital Extreme Definition. DXD is just a name given to normal PCM audio, but since it sounds like DSD, intentionally or not, the streaming community now calls 352.8 kHz files DXD2. Anyway, DSD recordings will be converted to DXD when post-production is needed, which is almost always the case. Editing, equalizing, dynamic range reduction, some more reverb and so on. By the way, with classical music, dynamic range reduction is essential to be able to play it in a living room. But this is normally done by manual gain riding based on the score and thus not by using a compressor. After all post is done, the files are converted back to DSD. This process is sold as being lossless in the sense that it doesn't degrade the audible quality. More realistic people call it a process with acceptable losses, which might be closer to the truth, although some will call it more acceptable than others. So why not release it as DXD then? Well, during the SACD time that was no option, since an SACD had to contain DSD audio. But now it would be an option, and in some cases this option is offered. But a 352.8 kHz 24-bit file uses 16.9 megabits per second, while a DSD64 that supposedly offers the same resolution only uses 5.6 megabits per second, and thus is far more efficient. This is part 1 of a 2-part series. Part 2 will cover the playback side of DSD with topics as ripping, downloading, file types and ways to play them back. As soon as the second part is published, I will link to it. So stay in contact by subscribing to this channel or my newsletter, or follow me on Twitter, Facebook or Google+. See the show notes for the links. If you have a question, post it below this video, but please don't ask me for buying advice. See my About Questions video to find out why. If you like this video, please consider supporting the channel through Patreon and see super exclusive videos too. Just $1 a month will do. The link is in the show notes. And don't forget to tell your friends on the web about this channel. I'm Hans Beekhuizen, thank you for watching and see you in the next show or on thehbproject.com. And whatever you do, enjoy the music.